Good evening on this Wednesday night. I'm glad you've joined me. I hope you've had a good week. I hope the election went yesterday well. I wish I knew how it went. I have to be honest and tell you that I'm presenting this on a pre-recorded in a pre-recorded fashion on election day. So when I get through tonight, I'm going to go home and find out how it's going. And I hope, as you're listening to this, that I'm happy, and I hope you're happy too. And I hope our nation is blessed and that God's will has been done. I want to remind you, or at least announce something that you haven't heard. I'm going to be saying it several times between now and Thanksgiving. This being November, we're in the holiday mode. We're still in the coronavirus year, so we're still distancing and wearing masks most of the time. We're going to celebrate as a church our Thanksgiving dinner like we do every year, but it's going to be slightly different this year. We're going to do it on Saturday at noon. We're going to hopefully receive a lot of you, for a good, beautiful, tasty Thanksgiving meal. It'll be at 12 o'clock. We're going to recognize some people in our city that have been working for our good through the last two hurricanes and also in face of the pandemic. We're going to also, at the end of that meal, as a church, provide some at least 200 meals to the community, folks who come and drive by to receive them. You'll be hearing more about it, more details. We'll be spacing the tables out a little bit. We'll be serving you. We'll be providing all the food here at the church. We'll be taking every precaution we can during these days. But that will be on the 21st of November, 12 noon on Saturday. That's getting out of the box. We've never done it that way before. And I hope if you're hearing my voice that you will feel the invitation and have a desire to come. Now, I want to get back into Genesis a little bit. I hope you've been listening. We've been doing this now for a long time, over 8 months, since March. But I'm at the point in Genesis chapter 9. I've entitled this portion of it, Noah, Noah, Noah. What were you thinking, Noah? You remember where we are. Noah has been the hero up to this point. God has favored him with his grace and blessing. He led Noah to build the ark. Noah has obeyed God in every way. Noah's done exactly what God told him to do. And we have talked about the flood. We went through it in detail. How many days they were on the flood, on the ark, and they built the altar. They sacrificed animals following the waters dispersal, and Noah has begun to recover his life with his family, and he builds an altar. You remember I just mentioned it's the first altar mentioned in the Old Testament, and he offers the sacrifice on the altar. And he's just doing what God's commanded him to do. Noah always seems to be doing the right thing. And that's important for us to know. In Genesis 9:1, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. So following the sacrifice in chapter 8 at the altar, God gave him a command. I want you to repopulate the earth. He gave Noah and these three boys of his that responsibility. The Bible will tell us that they were faithful in doing that. That by these three sons, the earth will be replenished. And that following that that major command, replenish the earth to replace all the people that have died in the flood, God gives a list of what I would call directions or commands. Here's just a summary of them. He says to them, not just summaries or commands, but he gives them a list of things they will expect. He says, from now on, the animals will be afraid of you. And, of course, we understand that today. But before the flood, that wasn't the case. They were able to bring the animals onto the ark because the animals weren't afraid of Noah. They weren't using them for meat. They were cohabitating with the animals. And it was after the flood, the animals became afraid. And animals are afraid of us. In chapter 9, the Bible very clearly says, God says it, that every moving thing will have fear to you. They will have a dread of you, and they will, every fowl, every bird, every beast of the earth will flee from you. And so today, if you're out deer hunting, you're probably not going to have the deer come and and shake hands with you. If he sees you, he's going to run. If you're hunting squirrels, they're not going to run. They're running from you. Animals do not like us. They're afraid of us. And so that began after the flood. He also says that these animals that will now be afraid of man will be for us meat to eat. He says that in chapter 9, that every living thing will be meat for you, as well as the herbs of the earth. So God has expanded their menu, and they can now eat the animals and will do so. But he gave them a restriction. He says, do not eat the blood. Do not drink the blood of animals. Do not eat the raw meat. Cook it, in other words, and it will be good meat for you. He then goes and says to Noah something very important, and it is a major topic of discussion that we will just touch on. God says to Noah, don't commit murder. Teach that, because if one commits a murder, I will require blood in return for it. He says that in verse 6 of chapter 9. He says, whoso sheds man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of God made he man. Now, why would he say to Noah that from this point forward, we will have capital punishment? Now, there are a lot of people that don't like that. I don't like it. I don't know anybody that wants to embrace capital punishment. I don't think any of us want it. But God's word says here that it is to be implemented in case someone kills someone who's made in the image of God. What that teaches us is something very important. We don't want to lose out what it teaches us just over the fact of capital punishment. God is teaching us that we are created in his image. We are made in the image of God. That means every human being on the face of the earth, man, woman, boy and girl, babies, grown men, old women, all of us are made after the image of God. And because we are made in the image of God, our life is valuable, and we are not to take that life away from anybody. We have one life to live. I wish I could remember who was talking about it yesterday. Maybe it was on a newscast, but listen, we only have one life. We've got one shot. I know who it was. It was on the news this morning. I heard a man who was battling cancer, and he made a point of the fact that I've got one life to live, got one shot at this world. And that's the way it is for all of us. We've been given life after the image of God. And for me or you to take one's life away from someone is to rob them of the one chance, the one life, the one existence they have on this earth. And because of that importance, because we are in his image and we have one life, God says, don't commit murder. And I believe he's using this capital punishment passage as a deterrent. I believe that is the reason he gives it to us. Yes, it's going to be implemented and has been throughout the ages, not in every place and in every case, and not fairly, I would add. But God is saying, don't commit murder against people made after my image, or you will lose your life. And so it was a deterrent. And why would God do that? There's a reason. There is a reason for that capital punishment. It wasn't just to punish, but it was to keep us from doing what Cain did. It was to keep us from doing what his great, 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 great grandson, Japheth, did. Murder started the downhill road into the flood and the destruction of the world. It was Cain in the beginning in the garden who murdered his brother Abel. And Cain went out from the presence of God. He began to deny God, live without God, built his cities, lived his life, birthed his families, and built an entire generation where God finally concluded that every thought in the mind of man was on evil continually. It began, obviously it began with Adam's disobedience of God, but murder was what led Cain away from God, never to return. And God sees that as the major step to the destruction of the world. And today, murder is the most despicable of crimes. Murder committed on the streets of our cities on a weekly, daily basis almost. Murder is the most horrible of crimes. And God says, don't do it. Don't do it. And so I would say, rather than argue over capital punishment and whether it should be implemented, we should be shouting from the mountaintop, thou shalt not kill, because mankind is made in the image of God. The death penalty is necessary because of what Cain did. Now, in Genesis 9, 7, here's the command that God gives. He says to Noah, "And you be fruitful and multiply. Bring forth abundantly to the earth and multiply therein." And that passage of Scripture can be used, I believe, as a proof text. Let me read it again. "You be fruitful and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth and multiply therein." God has never stopped that command. Now I want you to think about that. He has never backtracked. He has never held up his hand and said, "That's enough." He has never said, "You have multiplied enough. You have replenished the earth." And you know something? You and I are not qualified to be the ones who say that it's enough. God said in the beginning, "Multiply, replenish, populate the earth. Bring forth abundantly." Don't just bring forth sparingly. Bring forth abundantly. And I believe this is a great proof text for what I've been saying a lot about lately. It's a great proof text for life. God says to mankind, "Bring forth life. Bring forth little boys and little girls, babies from the mother's womb. Bring forth abundantly." And that passage alone can be and must be used and implemented as a biblical argument against the practice of abortion. Well, God then, after giving a list of requirements along with some directions and commands, he then makes a covenant with Noah. I'm just going to touch on it briefly. In chapter 9, verse 9, God says to Noah, "He spake unto Noah and his sons and said, Behold, I will establish my covenant with you and with your seed after you." And then he makes a promise that to man that he's made, to every living creature, every fowl, every cattle, every living thing on the earth, that he will establish his covenant with them and that he will never again cut off all flesh by the waters of the flood. Neither shall any more there be a flood to destroy the earth. So God says to Noah, "I promise you, Noah, from now on I will never again destroy the earth with water." And so it's a promise God made. Now this is a one-way covenant. This is a very famous covenant, the first covenant we see with God. But God enters into it with man. Man doesn't enter into it with God. God says to man, Noah, "I promise you, there will be no more destruction of the earth by water." And he says, to remind you of it, I'm going to set my bow in the sky. And when the clouds come and the rains fall, my bow will be in the cloud to remind you that my covenant has been established and I will not destroy the earth. Why the rainbow? Why was it necessary for God to put a rainbow in the clouds? The other day, driving to Lake Charles, I saw the most beautiful rainbow maybe I've ever seen. I literally saw where it started all at the top of the trees, and it was a complete bow all the way to the other end where I saw it disappear into the trees, beautiful in its multicolored beauty. You see, Noah had never seen rain before. And the first time he saw the rain, it didn't stop. It kept raining. And kept raining and kept raining until the earth was covered with the water. And God says to him, "Listen, don't be afraid when it rains again. Because it's going to rain again." And it may be that the rain hadn't come yet a second time when the covenant was made. So maybe it was that God was preparing to send another rain to the earth to water the land. And he wants Noah not to be afraid. What would you think one would think, would Noah think if after the flood, He gets up one morning and all of a sudden it's raining again? Well, he doesn't have the ark anymore. I don't know where the ark is. Maybe he's dismantled it. But, well, it probably put up somewhere, maybe close by. But he was not prepared. And it would be a fearful thing. He hadn't got the animals ready. He hadn't got food supply. But God says, "Don't worry. I'm not going to destroy the earth. So when it rains again, Noah, don't be afraid. Just look at the bow in the sky or in the clouds and you be reminded that I will no longer ever again destroy the earth with a flood." Now, years will then pass. We don't have every detail that takes place, but the years pass and God blesses them. And that's what God does. In Genesis 9, the Bible describes how in verses 14, 15, 16, 17, how God blesses them And that's what God does. God blesses. He has blessed my life. I know He has blessed your life as well. And through the years that pass on the earth following the flood, Genesis 9:18 introduces us to the three sons of Noah by name. And they are Shem, Japheth, and Ham. Now there's something interesting about Ham. Ham's son is mentioned. Noah's first grandson is by the name of Canaan. If you don't believe the Bible is the literal word of God, then you need to read about Canaan. Canaan here is not the nation of Canaan. This is the grandson of a godly, perfect, gracious man named Noah. Canaan. But we're going to know that Canaan, this Canaan, will be the one who is the namesake of the nation called Canaan, who will be the number one enemy of Israel in the years that will come later. So these three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, are going to be very, very important now. The whole earth will be inhabited by these three sons, according to the scripture. My time is just about up. And what I've done thus far, and I want to close out to get ready for next week, this, that, and I hope I haven't been, I hope I haven't missed it in my presentation to you. Noah has survived the flood. He has built the altar. He has sacrificed the animals. He has received a covenant from God. He has three sons that were on the boat with him, and a grandson now that's been born, and he's been given directives by God, and he's going to do this, and as he does what God says, we're getting ready now for what I call Noah, Noah, Noah. Why did you do it? The sin of Noah is one of the great mysteries in the Bible. I may have said too much getting up to it, but I really wanted to build up to it. Noah's sin is something we like to ignore. I mean, after all, the Bible says he was a perfect man and upright, that he did all that God commanded him to do. The Bible says he found grace in the eyes of God. And then Noah commits the most hideous of sins. That's what we're going to talk about. Noah, Noah, Noah. Why? Why did you do it? And I believe there's a reason that we can understand a little bit, not for his sin, but I think we can learn some incredible, incredible truth about what came to pass out of his life from the sin. We're going to see Noah's salvation in the Old Testament, but his salvation is a New Testament salvation. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Noah, and we thank you for his life and all that he did and accomplished. We thank you for his sons, his family. I thank you, Lord, for his faithfulness and obedience to you. I thank you for your grace that was extended to him. That is the reason today he is in glory with you. I pray, God, that you would be with us as we go from this study to the next, that between now and next Wednesday you would direct the flock, bless the people, help us, Lord, to be faithful. We pray for our church and our community. We pray for those that are sick, that they would be well. We pray for our nation. We pray for the unrest around the country. We pray that a unified nation will result and that our nation will be a true, godly, faithful, Christian people as we were established to become. Forgive us our sins, and we pray that you would increase our faith. In Jesus' name, amen.